A reading from the book of Isaiah. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen in whom my soul delights. I have put in my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord, I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeons, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and the new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you, the word of the Lord.
Psalm 29. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter began to speak to them, to Cornelius and the other Gentiles. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
There are dates in all of our lives that stand out, that give shape to who we are, that give a sense of identity or purpose or destiny, that for good reasons and sometimes for sad reasons give a molding to our very being. Now, I happen to come from a family that is very good about remembering dates. All three of my brothers are, in fact, are ridiculous about remembering dates. Every single morning, one of them initiates a group text between the four brothers telling us that on this day we remember the birthday of Marquis de Lafayette or the signing of such and such a treaty or when the movie The Searchers was released and so forth. So we like dates in my family. And as I look back on my life, there are a bunch that stand out, that gave shape to my very being. I think, for example, of June 16th, 1984, when I had the very good fortune to marry a young woman named Jan. Or the next year, on June 15th and December 21st of 1985, when respectively I was ordained to the diaconate and then the priesthood. Or July 1st that same year when I began serving in my first congregation. There is May 2nd, 1981, when after singing, to brag a little bit, a small solo on the stage of Carnegie Hall, the Chicago Symphony and Chorus, I realized that I wasn't called to be a singer, but was in fact called to be a priest. June 2nd, 1998, when I received my doctorate. Some of the dates are sad, as I said. There was February 13th, 1986, when my beloved maternal grandmother died at the age of 96, or May 16th, 1993, when my father died, too young, too quickly. There are a few other dates in there as well, including, for example, March 1st, 2011, when I came back to Holy Comforter as rector. And then, of course, maybe for all of us, November 2nd, 2016, when, against all odds, the Cubs finally won the World Series. Do you notice, though, there is one day that I didn't mention, but I remember it. I don't remember it consciously, so to speak, but I know the date, and that was May 29th, 1959, when in the tiny church of St. John the Divine in Garden Grove, Iowa, at the hands of Father Charlie Fletcher, I was baptized. Baptized into the household of God, into the community of faith, into the family of Christ. Now, it's worth mentioning that, in fact, that church no longer exists. I was the very last baby baptized there, and I'll let you sort of work out what that might mean. It's also worth mentioning that I am maybe the only person I know who actually possesses the baptismal font in which he was baptized. It's actually just a small, dented, tarnished Paul Revere bowl. But when the church closed, it went to my grandmother, and then to my mom, and now to me. And every now and then, as I'm going through things, I'll come across that old Paul Revere bowl, and I'll ponder for a moment my baptism, which, as I said, I don't remember, but which I know the date and all the details. Because it is from that day that all the other days flow. It is from that identity-bestowing moment that the rest of my journey takes shape. We are here today to celebrate the feast of the baptism of our Lord and to enjoy the great delight of welcoming four new siblings into the family of faith. And this is an important day. This baptism of our Lord is an important day because it brings us face to face with a critical reality about Jesus' life. To be honest, the baptism of Jesus is an event that has troubled scholars and theologians and preachers and priests for nearly 2,000 years. Because if Jesus truly was without sin, if he was perfection personified as we've always been taught, then why did he need to go through the baptism of repentance to which John the Baptist was calling the people of Judea, of Israel? Why did Jesus, who was without sin, need to be cleansed of sin? And so people, preachers and scholars, theologians, have wrestled with this for a long time. And in fact, if you look at the four different Gospels in the New Testament, each one handles this moment differently. There's almost a sense in which, to be honest, there's a little bit of embarrassment, or like, we're not sure how to deal with this or what to say about it, so we're just going to give you some sort of sketchy details. And the four, as I say, do differ. As one of my favorite authors said, if somebody tells you something that it is not in their best interest for you to know, it's probably true. And so the baptism of Jesus, as troubling as it might be from a theological standpoint, is nevertheless an iconic moment in his life. The reality is, we are just a week or so into the season of Epiphany, the season where there is a constant unfolding, revealing, manifesting of who Jesus is. It began with the annunciation of the angel in that private moment to Mary, and then the repetition of that same annunciation to Joseph. It took form, human form, when Jesus was incarnated in that humble setting in Bethlehem. His identity as the Holy One of God was confirmed by the angels who sang sweetly from the clouds and by the shepherds who gambled across the plains to see this child. And then those three exotic visitors from the East, those wise men, came bearing their strange gifts, affirming that this child was holy beyond all others. And this entire season of Epiphany is a continuing series of unfolding moments where Jesus' identity as the Holy One of God is revealed. Like layer by layer, step by step, we see more broadly, more deeply, more richly who he was. And his baptism was the first public moment as an adult when Jesus' identity was affirmed, confirmed, and appropriated. And so perhaps that's why he was baptized. Not because he needed the baptism of repentance, but because in that very act, as he was about to inaugurate his public ministry, Jesus chose sides. Jesus chose to be identified with the very people he had come to claim, to renew, to bring back to God. Jesus could very easily have stood on the banks of the Jordan shouting encouragement to the sinners going into the water. He could have preached another eloquent sermon, as he did several times. He could have worked some marvel or wonder, but he didn't. Instead, he chose to enter into the water of the font, of the river, so that there he might be fully, completely identified with the very people he had come to serve and save and love. And in that regard, as Jesus went into the water, he promised to go with us wherever we go. Into the dark and scary and joyful and lovely moments of our lives. Into those places where we need the presence of the Holy One, the Holy Spirit. He promised always to be our companion, not as one aloof and distant, but as one who marched through the very experiences that we experience. And not about you, I find great comfort in that. That the one who heals and renews and saves is one who has experienced our very reality. For anyone who has, for example, wrestled with pride or the temptation to seek status or standing, how comforting it is to know that Jesus faced those same enticements and turned his back on them. For those of us grieving the death of a loved one, how comforting to remember that Jesus wept at the grave of his friend Lazarus and felt that very sorrow that we feel. For those of us who have, perhaps at different times, been nudged aside by the world or felt like outcasts or persecuted in some way or oppressed, again, what a source of strength to know that those experiences were not alien or foreign to Jesus because he encountered all of them. So in the baptism, at the very beginning of his public ministry, Jesus chooses to be identified with God, yes, but chooses to be identified with us. With us. And that ultimately is what our baptisms mean too, isn't it? That we choose to be identified with the one who has chosen us. And that's why whenever we celebrate a baptism, as we get the great joy today to do, we all renew our own baptismal covenant. And I know it's probably tempting sometimes just to go through the words in a rote fashion. But we are reminded every time we celebrate a baptism of why we do it. We are called to confess our faith in Father, Son, and Spirit. We pledge to take our place at God's holy table and be nourished by God's holy meal. We promise that we will seek and serve the Christ in each other and all people, that we will work for justice, for peace, for love, that we will re-choose to be identified with the one who has chosen us. That's what happens when we renew our baptismal covenant, and it takes us back to our own baptismal moments when, for many of us, we were too young to know what was happening. But promises were made on our behalf, just as we do so today for our four new siblings, that we will work to be God's people, enlivened by God's Spirit, loving in God's name. Baptism is not magic. Baptism is not death insurance. Baptism is not a societal norm or simply something that is done to us. Baptism is our act of choosing God who has chosen us. It is our act of saying we go into the water just as Jesus did, so that we might rise to new life just as Jesus did. And the third century theologian Tertullian said, we only live by remaining in the water. Isn't that a wonderful image? We only live by keeping one foot in the font or the river or the lake or the stream. That connection to our baptism shapes everything else about who we are and our relationship with the one who has chosen us. Baptism is a time of great joy and delight and an opportunity for us to remember who we are. But it's also a chance, especially today, to remember that when Jesus was baptized, what was the first thing that happened when he came out of the water? The dove descended as a sign of the presence of the Spirit, and then that voice from heaven, the voice of God saying, this is my Son, the Beloved. Jesus is given a new name and a new identity. He enters the font, a carpenter. He exits the river, a Messiah. He is given the name Beloved. And that's the name we were given when we were baptized. That's the name we are going to give our four new siblings in just a minute. Beloved. Beloved of God, who for whatever reason, sometimes against rhyme or reason, looks at us and is well pleased. We are given in baptism the identity that Jesus was given, that of being the beloved of God, called to seek and serve Christ, called to love and proclaim the good news of God, called to reach out to the forgotten and the broken and the outcast, called to embrace the forgotten, called to love the unlovely and unlovable. And all because of our new identity, our new name. And is it remarkable? Is it impossible to believe that, in fact, at our baptisms, at the baptism today, every time we renew our vows, God calls us once again, beloved, my beloved daughter, my beloved son. And likewise, looks at us and says, with you, I am well pleased.
like to invite any of the children who would like to come forward to see a little bit better to please do so now. For holy baptism from the Florey family will now be presented. The candidates for holy baptism from the Kerr family will now be presented. Will you be responsible for seeing that the children you present are brought up in the Christian faith and life? Will you, by your prayers and witness, help these children to grow into the full stature of Christ? Do you renounce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God? Do you renounce the evil powers of this world which corrupt and destroy the creatures of God? Do you renounce all sinful desires that draw you from the love of God? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love? Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord? Will you who witness these vows do all in your power to support these persons in their life in Christ?
We will. Let us join with those who are committing themselves in Christ and renew our own baptismal covenant. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? In God, the Holy Spirit.
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord? You proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ.
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
Let us now pray for these persons who are to receive the sacrament of new birth.
Deliver them, O
Lord.
Grant, O Lord, that all who are baptized into the death of Jesus Christ, your Son, may live in the power of his resurrection and look for him to come again in glory, who lives and reigns now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Thank you, Almighty God, for the gift of water. Over it, the Holy Spirit moved in the beginning of creation. Through it, you led the children of Israel out of their bondage in Egypt and into the land of promise. In it, your son Jesus received the baptism of John and was anointed by the Holy Spirit as the Messiah, the Christ, to lead us through his death and resurrection from the bondage of sin into everlasting life. We thank you, Father, for the water of baptism. In it, we are buried with Christ in his death. By it, we share in his resurrection. Through it, we are reborn by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, in joyful obedience to your Son, we bring into his fellowship those who come to him in faith, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now sanctify this water, we pray you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, that those who here are cleansed from sin and born again may continue forever in the risen life of Christ our Savior. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. To receive this light of baptism as a reminder of the light that shines within you. Amen. Amen. Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Then receive the light of Christ as a reminder of the new light that shines within you. You in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Scarlet, you are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever. Amen. Scarlet, receive the light of baptism as the reminder of the new light that shines within you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that by water and the Holy Spirit, you have bestowed upon your servants the forgiveness of sin and have raised them to the new life of grace. Sustain them, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them an inquiring and discerning heart, the courage to will and persevere, and a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Amen. Let us welcome the newly baptized. Receive you into the household of God. Confess the faith of Christ crucified. Proclaim his resurrection and share with us in his eternal priesthood.
Peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in Jesus Christ our Lord, you have received us as your sons and daughters, made us citizens of your kingdom, and given us the Holy Spirit to guide us into all truth. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. The night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country where with all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.